Hey, here we go. We're in men's boot camp. We are going to deal with what we've just been talking about, probably one of the most important topics in the scripture, and that is, how do you pull the grace of God into your life and live a supernatural life? That's what we're going to talk about. And so we've got these handouts. They go in the slot called Faith Goals. Okay, Faith Goals. And don't let that phrase scare you, because it's really just how we access the grace of God. So we're going to just read some of these verses about grace. And by the time we're done tonight, we're going to spend time asking the Lord to give us some faith goals in three areas of life. Okay? In three areas of life. The kingdom of God within you. We're asking God to expand the kingdom of God within you. We're asking God to expand the kingdom of God between each person's relationships at home and in life. That's between us. And then we're asking God to expand the kingdom, give us grace to advance the kingdom around us. So in us, between us, around us. We need the grace of God to rule and reign, bring his kingdom on the earth. And so this world of grace is otherworldly. We're actually accessing another realm of reality. We're pulling that realm to this realm. But let's read some Bible verses, okay? Let's know we're on good, solid ground. So first verse, I just want to read out of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. It says, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love which he loves us with, even when we were dead in our trespasses or our sins, he made us alive together with Christ." See, we were raised with Christ. By grace, you've been saved. And you've been raised us, and he raised us up with him, and he seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, and we're created in Christ Jesus for good works, which he prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Okay, so the Bible teaches that in the eternal ages, he foreordained and predetermined in a transdimensional world above space and time, you existed in the spirit world, and he had you in mind many, many millions of years ago. That's what the Bible teaches. He foreordained your existence, and at a certain point in time in history, he unleashed your spirit onto the earth into your current body, and he had prepared before the beginning of time works for you to do by the grace of God. You can't do these works. These aren't works that you do in the flesh. These are supernatural things you'll do on the earth by the power of God. That's what it says in Ephesians. Oh, wow. Let's read some more verses. "And God is able to make all," everybody say all, "all grace abound." God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. You see, the work you're called to do can't be done apart from the grace of God. Get my point? You see how they work together? Your destiny, your calling, your identity, all that is contingent upon how much grace you appropriate in your life. So this is a big deal, right? The topic of grace. It's a very big topic in Scripture. Okay. "And God is able to make grace abound." Okay, now, next verse, Romans 5:17. "How much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ?" So the only way you're going to reign in life, rule and reign in life, in all the jurisdictions of life, is if you appropriate a lot of grace. You got to get a lot of grace to do what God's called you to do. Everybody got that? Okay. "So, by the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder." Paul, as an apostle, operated under supernatural grace, and it gave him the capacity to lay foundations, to be a wise master builder. Now, you know that all of you are builders, right? You're called to build lives. You're called to build. You're a builder, yes? Now, you can be a bad builder and put some creepy lean-to together that the wind of Wyoming can blow over. Or you can be a wise master builder and build with excellence. And that's going to require the grace of God. So you're either going to be a good builder or a bad builder. Paul says, he had no problem saying, I'm a wise master builder. He goes, listen, I got it. I figured out how to build. Now, you know, Paul was a terrorist. He was just like our current ISIS. He killed people in the name of religious energy and zeal. But he got converted and he appropriated the mercy of God. He got forgiven. And then the grace of God. And with the grace and mercy of God together operating in his life, he became one of the greatest master builders in all history. He laid the foundations of Christ in the kingdom. And he literally was the human agency to catapult the kingdom of God onto the earth. I mean, as a murderer, as an ISIS, as a terrorist. Now, so that means you've got hope. There's hope for you. No matter what's going on in your life, if you see Jesus and appropriate the grace of God, you can launch into being a wise master builder that has eternal impact in the lives of other people that bleeds into eternity. Like, how fun is that? It all depends on how much grace you get in your life. So this thing of grace is a big deal. Let's look at this. Okay, let us approach God's throne of grace. Wow! Approach his throne of grace with confidence. Not out of shame and guilt and humiliation and disgrace and rejection, but in confidence as a son because you've been purchased with blood. You didn't produce yourself, and you didn't die for yourself. The blood of Jesus covers you, no matter what you've done. So under the blood of Jesus, you get the right to go straight to your daddy, and he is a good dad. He's like into you, and he's got a stockpile, a reservoir of great grace that he wants to pour out upon you because you ask God for the Holy Spirit, and he's not going to give you a serpent. He says, how of you, though being evil, if your kids come and ask you for food, would you give him a serpent? He says, how much more? The word, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to them who ask? The grace of God couldn't be more manifested than the actual person of the Holy Spirit who is here right now inside of us and around us. So we go to the throne of grace with confidence as sons of God bought with the blood of Jesus so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Wow. And the time of need isn't just like, you know, the only time you call on him is when you're in a bad place. Time of need means all the time because your job is to advance the kingdom wherever you are. That's your time of need, which is all the time. Your time of need is I need a current of the unseen realm flowing through my life. Okay, now, you're saved by grace. The word saved in the Greek is sozo. Okay, sozo is a really big word. It's not just you're getting out of hell and going to heaven. Sozo is you're made whole and into Christ's likeness, and it's the capacity to bring his kingdom on earth. To be saved means a comprehensive work in your life. You're made whole. It means healed, delivered, and made whole. That's what the word saved is. And Jesus is the Savior, meaning he's the being that transforms you. Not only saves you and gets you to become a new creation, but he transforms you into the likeness of Christ. Okay, so the saving of you and the saving of the world is what we'll call kingdomizing. We're going to kingdomize people, kingdomize Laramie. God wants to save Laramie. By that, he wants to make Laramie whole. He wants saved marriages. Meaning he wants kingdomized marriages. He wants kingdomized people. He wants kingdomized businesses. He wants a kingdomized military. He wants a kingdomized social and civil servants. He wants kingdomized life. And so he has a comprehensive plan to bring his kingdom from that realm to this realm through the reigning sons. So God your father has the family business. It's called the Kingdom of God, Almighty and Sons. And you are a very important player in the father's business, the family business. And so he has got an assignment for you, a work for you to do, a destiny for your life. He's got people for you to reach out to and change and disciple. He's got cities for you to reach. And if you're faithful in a little, you know, your daddy is going to put you in charge of big departments in the whole company, and eventually you'll rule cities in the millennial age to come. How cool is that? Now, that's the story. That's the narrative that is in the Bible. Ruling and reigning, we start with it, we end with it. And it's all throughout the story of the salvific purpose of God. All right, now, grace is that substantial power to do the will of God. Grace is a very big word. The word in the Greek is charis. Charis. It's where we get the word charismatic. Okay, charis, the word for grace, and you can write that down, write it on your note. Charis. You should know some of these Greek words. Charis literally means gifts. So the charismatic movement means the movement that rediscovered the gifts. But it means more than just gifts. It means all of God's goodness. All of God's goodness. It's in the scripture in James, it says, all good things come from heaven. So the grace of God is the desire from heaven to do the will of God, and it's the power to pull it off. It's the desire and the power to do the will of God. That's the grace of God. In other words, the grace of God upgrades your motivation. Do you know that there's a thing called motivational poverty? Motivational poverty is when you don't have the wherewithal, the desire to get your butt up and go to work. And motivational poverty is a very serious thing that's like a cancer bleeding into our cities. Does that make sense? There's several kinds of poverty. There's motivational poverty, there's relational poverty, there's financial poverty, there's spiritual poverty. There's lots of forms of poverty. But one of the biggest forms of poverty is motivational poverty. And it's being unleashed on people through the spirit of entitlement, where I can go limp, or this thing that God owes me, or I don't have any, I don't have to cooperate with the purposes of God. I just wait and let God do me. It's hyper-Calvinism. God will do what God wants to do. I have nothing to have to do with. I have no need to cooperate with it. And it produces a spirit of laziness. Well, a motivational surge of heaven is dunamis power. Dunamis power enters into your spirit. See, what happened was an infusion of motivational energy hit your spirit. And it goes, not going to be afraid of man anymore. I'm not going to do business as usual. I'm not going to give nice old devotionals. I'm going to move under the power of God and speak the word of God. And I honestly, I think you get around men that are on that same page and you pick up the anointing that's in the room. We pick up your anointing. We pick up, we give our anointing, and we basically cross-pollinate. And what we want is a geometric explosion of anointings. But we want motivational poverty to be done with. So the people have the dunamis power of God and the motivation, the incentive to get up and get at it in the kingdom. Forceful men advance the kingdom. That's motivational energy. It's an energia. That's another word in Greek, energia. It's the energy of God, the grace of God to do his will. Now, maybe you don't know this, but there's several levels of God's grace. There's a thing in the Bible called the general grace of God. God reigns on the just and the unjust. Hospitals, schools, things like that, clean water. We operate in the general grace of God, all the time. The general grace, you got that? Okay. There's another thing called the saving grace of God. That means God inspires a person to respond to him. He initiates his love to them, his mercy, and he draws them to himself. That's the saving grace of God. He initiates the transformation of a human being. Okay, now there's sanctifying grace. That means the ongoing ability to become more and more like Jesus. Every minute, every hour, every day. That's the sanctifying grace of God. Then there's this phrase in Scripture. I just love this phrase. It's called the great grace. The great grace. That is like dang grace. And in the book of Acts, it talks about dying grace. It says they had all things in common, which is extraordinary. Tight-wadded Jewish people. Scot-Irish people like me. They got together, and under the unusual generosity of heaven, they caught a vision for grace. And they had all things in common, and they prayed together. And it says that in that unity and in that submission to a delegated authority, the apostles and the prophets, in other words, they understood delegated authority, which we're going to talk about in a minute, and they pulled on the grace of God through the apostles and the prophets. And that unity, that mutual submission, that level of faith, it says God unleashed great grace on them. And great grace is mountain-moving grace. Great grace is the supernatural than the miraculous. And that's what you're climbing into. You're moving in from sanctifying grace into great grace. Unfortunately, a lot of people develop a theology based on their experience versus the Word of God. So they said, because I don't experience healing for today, I guess he's not doing it anymore. So they stopped with sanctifying grace, and they would not appropriate great grace and greater works than these. So they didn't let the Bible inform them. They let their experience form their and shape their theology. Bad, bad. Don't do that. Don't do that. Because we're graduating. We're moving into great grace. And I believe the reason why we're not seeing the dead being raised and more healings, it's not just because of your individual faith. It's because corporately we're in such massive unbelief. All those verses that we read that had you in it, those weren't singular yous. Those were plural yous. You know, in the English language, you can say you and speak to a singular person. Or you can say y'all, you, all. That's a plural you. And all these promises are plural. So it's going to require a corporiety for the unleashing of the supernatural. It's not just you breaking through. It's us that has to break through. So I know a lot of people say, man, if I had more faith, I could go out and raise the dead. I said, well, you know, first of all, you shouldn't put all that pressure on yourself. Because for one thing, this is a corporate promise that's going to require the body of Christ in a larger setting to appropriate these promises. But great grace is a big deal. Now, there's a corresponding faith that works with these graces. There's general faith. You had general faith when you drove here. In other drivers, in your car, in your brakes, in your steering wheel, right? We're having general faith in this, in the architecture of this building, which is a little scary because I've seen the architecture of this building. So there's general faith. There's saving faith. I place my faith in Jesus. I trust in a person and he saves me. He transforms me from darkness to light. There is sanctifying faith. I have an ongoing faith in this person who's transforming me. And then the Bible teaches that there's a faith called the gift of faith. It's the faith of God, where God's faith drops into you and it's mountain moving faith. So saving faith and sanctifying faith, we could call that mustard seed faith. But man, this mountain moving faith is a gift, is a gift of the Holy Spirit. And it gets in you, and you know that God's here, angels are here, the supernatural is here, and you access that realm by faith, and boom, signs and wonders start operating. Things start moving, snap, crackle, and popping. Things start breaking out because you've tapped into the other realm. How fun is that? So grace and faith, there's levels. And we want to go all the way up, right? Let's not stop. Let's just get there. Let's go after this. Now I want to help you know that it says we go to the throne of grace. Okay, this is a very interesting statement because the throne of grace is a literal throne. It's not figurative. It's literal. God has a throne. There is a heavenly realm. There's another dimension of reality. And, you know, it says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it goes, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Everybody just say not seen. Not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. Commendation. That was a good thing. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. Oh, wow. Work with me here. The material world that we love to tinker with, invent things in, and manipulate and adjust, grow things, build things, the material world, where did it come from? It came from another realm, right? It calls it the unseen realm. In Ephesians, it says the heavenly realm. Now, here we're talking about the throne of God. Wow. Our Father who art in heaven. Wow. You're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Wow. We're talking about the unseen realm was the source of the production of the seen realm. Wow. So that there must be another dimension of reality, a trans-dimensional world that is outside of space and time and material stuff, right? Okay. So I'm going to call that the fifth dimension. Work with me. Okay, work with me. The throne room place, let's call it the fifth dimension of reality. Okay, now I am definitely not in the category of a scientist, but you guys that studied geometry and studied math, and so I'm about to wander into a dangerous place. But there's this thing that we learned in geometry called a plane. Yes? A plane. Then we learned in geometry that if you put planes together, you can form a what? A cube. Right? Planes put together, you form a cube. So you got a plane, that's one dimension of reality. A cube, that's dimension two. Space around the cube, let's call that three. So right now, we have a plane, we have a planet, and we have space around the planet. So that's called space, right? Now, in the Bible, oftentimes, when it refers to the space around the planets, it's called the heavens. The heavens declare the glory of God. But that's not talking about the fifth dimension. That's talking about the third dimension. You tracking? Yeah. Now, let's call the fourth dimension what Paul says. He says, there was a man who went to the third heavens. He's talking about himself. Okay? So let's call the fourth dimension what Paul would call the second heavens, where the demonic and the angelic operate. There is supernatural, but a lot of times it's counterfeit. So they're manipulating, they're levitating, they're altering things, they're exchanging a healing for a higher demon. They're doing transactions in the unseen realm. It's the world of the new age. And it's the beautiful side of evil. There was actually a book written, The Beautiful Side of Evil, which is white magic. So people that operate in new age and white magic, they manipulate through through the power of the demonic mixed with the power of the human soul. And Watchman Nee wrote a book called The Latent Power of the Soul, and he explained how people could be in like Nepal and operate and levitate and operate in power, but it wasn't God's power. It was second heaven power. So it's the fourth dimension. And by the way, religion operates in the fourth dimension. And it's the most dangerous place to be. Fourth dimension is it when you're dabbling with the demonic, and you can interact with the demonic through your soul, through sin. So sin opens the door to the demonic infusion of influence in your life. And it can come through your mind. Demons can whisper to your mind. They can adjust your heart. And if you allow those negative thoughts, and if you allow those negative things, those demons interact, and you become co-rulers with the demonic. Principalities and powers. You permit the demonic to operate. And the only way they can operate in the earth is through the skin. It's through skin. They need skin to manipulate because there are disembodied beings. Demons are disembodied, malevolent beings. They were angels that fell, from God under the leadership of Lucifer. So these angels in the fourth dimension, they want to cooperate with you by getting you to believe a lie so that they can take over your skin and keep ruling and reigning and manipulating the earth. Are you with me? So far, so good? Now, the fifth dimension, that's the third heaven. That's the what Paul called the third heaven. That's the heavenly realm, the heavenly dimension. That's the throne room realm. Now, that fifth dimension realm, now, I know the Bible doesn't say five dimensions and all that. I'm just trying to help you understand, okay, our scientific male brains. This is helpful. So What we do is we go into that throne, we go into that place as sons of God through the blood of Jesus. We ask God to renew our minds so we're not open to Satan. We get our hearts cleansed so our motives are His glory. We yield our bodies as a living sacrifice, Romans 12:1. We become sons of light, and we go before our Father of light into the heavenly realms, which where you are right now. You see, your spirit man is in heaven right now, and it's always in heaven. Heaven isn't like on the other side of the galaxy. Heaven is another dimension of reality. So when you go to your Father, you go straight into the other dimension of reality through the blood of Jesus, and you pull from that realm to this realm, and you become a co-ruler, a co-creator with God. You're not God, but you're partnering with God as a son. Now that makes prayer understandable now. See, prayer makes no sense if you don't understand the power of skin, as Miles Monroe calls it, your dirt body. Because God said in a decree, He bound His own power with His own word. He says, let them rule. He goes, it's got to take a dirt body to rule. I am not going to bypass dirt bodies. I need people to rule and reign on the earth. So Satan is trying to take over so he can rule. Take over your dirt body so you can do incantations and black magic and white magic and or basically just good old-fashioned manipulation and control, which is witchcraft. The minute you impose your will on the will of another, you are operating in witchcraft. The minute you speak a judgment and negativity about something, you're bringing a curse. And you are unleashing and permitting demons to operate in that other person's life. Yeah? But you're in the fourth dimension. And so that's why you got to control your attitude and your tongue. Fifth dimension people, we go in our dirt bodies and we're cooperating with God. God says, I won't move unless you ask me to, because I bound myself to your intercession. So God comes and says, what are we going to do here, Aaron? And you go, God, what do you want to do? And I'm going to abide in you and I'm going to let your words abide in me. And your daddy whispers, I want to kingdomize your company. Done. He goes, and then he sits there and goes like this. Like he folds his hands and he sits there and goes. And Aaron goes, well, you know, then do it. He goes, I can't. Well, Aaron goes, but you're sovereign God. He goes, yeah. And I said, let them rule. Let you rule. Well, what am I supposed to do? He goes, you have not because you asked not. Speak to your company. Talk to it. Now, don't beg. Don't get, oh, God, please, 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 bring your kingdom. Bring me. He goes, that's a plaintive beggar prayer. Talk to me like a son. Talk to me like a bride. Talk to me like I like you. Talk to me like I'm good. Stop treating me like, you know, like I'm some not good guy that doesn't really want to do this unless you beg enough and cry and scream enough. Because I'm really into you and I'm really into your company. Speak it, son. Speak it. I've given you authority to decree and declare what I want to do here. You're my son, my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. Come on now. Do this. And so Aaron goes, oh boy, here we go. He goes, God, am I in the throne room? Yes. Why? How do I know? Because you have faith in my blood, not my good works. Not my good works, but I had a bad attitude and I didn't speak well to my April. That's okay. I forgive you. Okay, God, I guess it's not by works, it's by faith, by grace, by mercy. Yes. Speak it for goodness sake. Get with it. So Aaron goes, I decree and declare. And what's the name of your company? So do it right now while I get a drink. Speak to Independent Heating. How'd that feel?
Pretty good.
Yeah. Well, guess what? How did God create from the fifth dimension? How did He create? And how do you create?
Must be the
same. Well put. Well put. Lesson learned. Now listen. That's why prayer, we do it without ceasing. We should be doing this all the time. We should be walking around speaking, releasing, decreeing, declaring, prayer walking, this business, that person. I decree, I declare, you shall be saved. That's how you walk in an apostolic authority. You're sent out, go into all the world, and your first step is to decree and declare through the prayer. Now, by the way, most of Jesus' prayers weren't requests, they were decrees. Be healed. Be gone. Stop it. Shut up. Most of his prayers weren't, oh God, please, I beg you. They're almost none of them. They were all, he operated like a one with authority, right? He talked with authority, he prayed with authority. Well, why aren't you doing that? It's going to change right now, yes? Like none, all this religious goofballness that we've been taught is gone as of today, yes? We're going to walk, I decree and declare that you're going to operate with as authoritative sons of God that rule and reign, and decree and declare from the fifth dimension into this dimension. You're going to bring that dimension to this dimension. How do you think we got this building? How do you think we got this church? By the grace of the power and the supernatural, by the fifth dimension throne room realm coming into this realm. How do you think we're going to see kingdomization of Laramie and the region? And churches getting the exact same way.
That's how Wyoming beat Boise State.
Exactly. You decreed and declared.
Safety, right?
Yeah, safety. Yeah. That safety was unbelievable. I was watching it. So are you understanding the throne room realm? We go to the throne of grace. You never have to worry if God's, mad at you, hates you, doesn't like you. Now, he may not like some of the things you do, but he never, never gets mad at you or never stops liking you. So most of us have an emotional resistance to the throne room, to this intimacy, because we think God's like our daddy, that he's performance-oriented, and that, we've disappointed him, so we can't possibly go and talk because we're so full of shame and guilt and condemnation. We're so humiliated. I can tell if a guy's under a religious spirit if he avoids God for more than 5 minutes. Yeah. Because guilt is a work of hell. That means the guy thinks that he actually earns his favor by being good. That is religion. It's not by works. Remember Ephesians 1? It's not by works, but by grace. We're saved by grace, not by works. So anybody that thinks that being good is what got him there will then be guilty if he's not good. And that sense of guilt is what keeps him away from the fellowship with God. Yeah, it's unbelief in a good father. And it's a spirit of religion. Another spirit of religion is if you secretly get irritated and annoyed and disgusted when someone else isn't doing well. And you feel that justifies you to pull them out of your life, I don't like what you're doing. That's a mistake. That's a sin. So now I can justify removing my fellowship from you. That's a spirit of religion. It's the most powerful demons operating on the planet is a spirit of religion. I mean, gosh, look at Islam. Look at all this stuff. It's religion. The Christian religion, very dangerous. All right, now, one point about grace, real quick. I'm not going to go into this very long. But grace comes directly from God, but it also comes directly through the conduit of human beings. And that's called mediated grace. Can everybody just say the word mediated grace?
Mediated
means the channel, the conduit. Like electricity, in order for it to be helpful, needs a channel or a conduit. Yes, it needs a wire. It needs a transformer. It needs a conductor. So conductors are the channels or the mediation of that power. All right, so the mediation of grace is people. And there are five jurisdictions of the kingdom, five governmental jurisdictions of the kingdom. Personal government, self-government, we've been over this. Marriage and family government, church government, marketplace government, and civil or social government. Those are the five areas of government described in Scripture that God delegates authority in. Yes, everybody got that? So God delegates human authority. He takes and releases an authority to that person and says, now your job is to conduct my grace to the other people. It's not for you, it's for them. So it says in Ephesians, God ascended into heaven, and it says he gave gifts to men, and some of those gifts are called apostles and prophets. They're human agencies that disseminate the grace of God. Now, there are pre-ascension apostles, you know, Peter, James, and John. They were, you know, on the earth walking with Jesus, and there are post-ascension apostles. And these apostles and prophets and teachers and pastors and evangelists and elders and deacons, all these in the church world, are agencies of grace. So the Bible teaches that when you submit to the Christ in that leader, the grace that he pours out through them gets onto you. The quality of your submission results in the degree of your grace. Did everybody get that point? Now, in the natural family, you see it in Ephesians, it says, children, what does it say? Honor your father and mother. It's in the Ten Commandments, by the way. It's the only commandment with a promise. Children, honor your father and mother. Submit to the delegated authority that I gave them. And it says, it will go well with you and you will live a long life. In other words, you'll be safe and successful if you honor them, if you submit to their authority, to the Christ, the authority that Christ gave them. Don't mess around with this. So I tell you what, the reason why a lot of us are walking around in less grace than we should be having is because when our dad and mom were dishonorable, we thought we had permission to dishonor them. So because they were dishonorable, we think, well, now because they're dishonorable, I have a right to dishonor them. And the minute you dishonor them, even if they're dishonorable, now you're under judgment. In other words, less grace gets into your life. You know, when we get hurt and offended, right? We get hurt and offended by our leaders, our parents, our church leaders, or whatever, our bosses. And so we talk about them. We bitch and moan and groan. We dishonor them. We rebel against them. We cop an attitude. And it shuts down. It puts a restriction on God's ability to pour grace to you. And you say, well, now, wait a minute. Why am I supposed to honor a dishonorable person? The answer is because the Bible told you to. So how? Well, then, if that's the case, then how do I do that? Well, that's a complicated answer. But just in a nutshell, the way you honor a dishonorable person is that you forgive them and then you bless them. And what that does is it counteracts in the spirit world, it counteracts the curses that it put on your life, and your blessing counteracted the curse, and you now reopen the channel of grace in your life by the way you responded to a dishonorable person. But you don't have the right ever to rebel, to dishonor, to gossip, to slander. You never get that option. Not in the marketplace, not in the family, not in the church, not in civil government. When we talk about a politician that is making bad policies, we have got to watch our tongues. You do not curse them. You do not dishonor them. You pray for them. Now, that doesn't mean you agree, and it's okay in the American democracy, the government that God gave us, to disagree rigorously, but we are not to speak demeaningly of another person. That's why this campaign is so horrific. It's just released all kinds of demonic energy in the atmosphere. The way it's gone is just so wrong. There's a way to challenge somebody that still has honor in it. And by the way, I am a function in an apostolic way, but I am submitted to other apostles. I am highly accountable to a lot of people. I don't get the right to just blow people off and dishonor the authority in my life. And I'm also submitted to the local elders. I'm submitted to an APES team. I walk in tremendous submission. And I listen to the Christ in mono. And I'm submitted to the Christ in mono and to Josh and to Andrew and to Bob. And so they're submitted to the Christ in me. And that culture of honor and that culture of submission is why we're flourishing as a church today. And it's not like I've done everything perfect. I haven't. And when I've made a mistake, Josh or Andrew have come to me with tremendous respect and honor and humility, and they submit. They make an appeal to me. They don't come with disrespect and dishonor. They make an appeal. They say, Papa T, we're here to appeal to you. You know, that conversation you had, it was not helpful. You went out of a boundary, and it confused people. And I'm in every single time, right? I think every single time, man, I am like on my face, really hitting the deck, because I see the spirit of it was honor. And then I honor them. I honor the Christ in them, and I submit. So the culture of humility is what attracts the grace of God. That's why humility is the mother of all motivational attitudes. Groups that emphasize vision and gifts and power, they're short-lived. Groups that emphasize humility, they're unstoppable. Because in the end, God gives grace to the humble. In the epistle that Peter wrote, he says, young men, he goes, submit to old men. That's what he said. Young men, submit to old men. He goes, why? Because God gives grace to the humble. And you know what? He's not talking about humble yourself before God. He does say that in other verses, by the way. He says, humble yourself before older men in the Lord. He goes, because when you do that, there's a transaction that takes place, and I then get to pour out my grace into your life, and you will start flourishing. You'll start benefiting. You'll start prospering. Now, Martin's attendant embarrassed the heck out of me. He's this apostle from Africa, and he comes in, he goes, it was very embarrassing for me. He goes, first of all, he confronted me in front of Mono. He goes, is it true? He goes, well, first of all, he goes, I'll bet it's true that everybody that comes under the influence of your leadership ends up winning in their life in almost every area. And he goes, is that true? And I went through the record. I went, you know, the people that do honor the Christ in me, they do end up winning. That's kind of true. I've never watched anybody really tank when they get into this narrow place, because I'm always going to go after Christ in the kingdom. You can, I mean, and if I deviate from that one bit, you come after me and smack me silly, because I'm going to go after the Word of God. I'm going to go after Christ in the kingdom. And so you say, very embarrassing conversation. He goes, so is that true? I go, you know, that's kind of true. And he goes, then you've got to stop apologizing for who you are. He goes, the fact is, you are a conduit of the grace of God. And that's your job. So therefore, you operate in the fear of the Lord. You better just realize that you can't mess up. Therefore, because lives are at stake, he goes, you've got to call people into a culture of honor. Not just to you, but to everybody. And I said, now that's embarrassing because it sounds self-serving. No, it isn't self-serving. You know, when you say to your kids, all right, listen, kids. You know, listen, Taylor and Ty, listen. Listen, Josiah, listen, you know, Josh and Sarah or whatever, whoever we're talking about, you need to honor your father and mother, and I'm not going to allow you for that attitude. Well, why? Is that self-serving? Well, kind of. It does make your life a little nicer, but it kind of is. Well, it does say in the scripture, hey, people, listen, give the elder a break. Stop making it hard to be an elder. I mean, it does say that. So it does say, kids, stop making it so hard to be a parent. But in the end, your real motivation is that you know that you're smarter than them. You know that you've got more in God. I mean, by that, I mean you're more wise than them. You know you've got more in God than they do, and that if they honor you, they're going to get the goods from you. But if they put a block in their heart up to you and they cop an attitude and speak negatively and get in rebellion, it's not going to go well for them. They're not going to be safe and successful. That's a dumb thing. And plus, you're training their little hearts to treat police like that, to treat bosses like that. So your job is to train kids to be obedient from the inside out. Obedient to authority that translates into obedience to God as their authority. Because the kingdom is all about government, and you'll only do as well in the kingdom as you are honoring and obedient to delegated authority. So this topic of a delegated authority is no little matter. Why? Because God mediates his grace through delegated authority. Now, yes, you're going to have to give an answer for your own government, self-government. But you're also going to give an answer for how you govern your families if you're married. Or how you are a son or daughter in your family. You're going to give an answer for how well you govern or submit in the marketplace and in the church and in civil government. Those five jurisdictions are really, basically, they're places for God to dispense his grace. All right, everybody got that point? Man, that's a whole other teaching. But I couldn't talk about grace and avoid the topic of the mediation of grace that does involve people. So I'm not going to apologize anymore for who I am in God. That just makes me a total servant. I have to walk as a total hidden servant before God, praying and fasting night and day for you, because I have a responsibility to disseminate grace. And if I stop disseminating grace, then man, there's a whole bunch of people you can call to kick my butt. But guess what? As you sow into honor, you will reap honor. So as you sow into yielding and submitting and humbling your hearts to each other and me to you and us to each other, guess what? We're creating a culture of presence, a culture of honor. That culture of honor sets you up to be able to rule and reign and influence other people in your lifetime. So it's not smart to be disrespectful and dishonoring and cop an attitude. Let's sow into honor. Let's sow into submission. All of us. We mutually submit to each other. By the way, no leader should say, you guys submit to me and I don't submit to you. That should never be the culture. In fact, the more higher you go in leadership in the kingdom, the more submitted you are to everybody else. Because in the kingdom, the higher the authority, the lesser the privilege. Did you just understand that? In other words, if you're going to be great in the kingdom, you're going to be a servant. So the higher the authority in the marketplace, see, this is not how we're taught. We're taught that in the marketplace, if I got the money, then I can, you know, I can be obnoxious and tell everybody what to do and just be a bully. I can be a bully because there's a paycheck on the other end of this thing, and I can intimidate you with money. That's not kingdom, people. That's not kingdom whatsoever. If you're a leader and a manager in a company, this is you're a pastor to these people. And your assignment, if you got greater authority, you have lesser privilege, meaning you have to operate as their servant, even though they're called to serve you. So in the kingdom, you don't lord over anybody. You're always a servant. But it doesn't take away the fact that you're a conduit of grace. So when I see people copping an attitude toward Mark and Shane and their company, or I hear about it, I get very nervous for them. And I think, uh-oh. Listen, these guys, they're copping an attitude. They're pinching off the grace of God, and that arrogance is going to get them in trouble. They're limiting the appropriation of grace in their life. And it's just crazy how it works. Why wouldn't you submit to your bosses who are out for your best interest, try to get products on the table that will benefit everybody? I mean, it's just crazy. Are you tracking with me now so far? Grace. Grace comes directly from God. It comes indirectly through people. Now, how do you get to this grace? First of all, let me just say that this book is a menu of the grace of God. It's a menu of the grace of God. I mean, literally, it's 66 books full of promise. I mean, this thing is rich with promise. Every page is promise, is grace. Every page. Now, you tap it by faith. So there's three areas that we want to tap into the grace of God. And I didn't get this in the notes, and I'm really sorry I didn't. But the first place that we're going to go after the grace of God is the kingdom of God, the grace of God within you. So let's just look at this. Let's just look at this, okay? And there's your hands, okay? And there's your face, and there's your smile, and okay. And there's your heart. Okay, so now, the grace of God comes in the form of wisdom and revelation. It comes in the form of wisdom and revelation so that you get the mind of Christ. Okay? The mind of Christ. You've got to think like Christ thinks, because if you got stinking thinking, it's going to block you. I remember a guy told me one time, he says, you don't have a money problem, you have a vision problem. You got stinking thinking. You're not seeing how God's seeing. You've got a limited vision, therefore it's limiting what God can do. He wants to do a lot more, but your mind is quarantining and boxing up God. You've got a religious mindset. Stop thinking like a pea-brained American and start thinking like a kingdom son. Get into heaven, get dreams and visions, and start letting your mind get expanded by Jesus. That's the point of dreams and visions. That's the point of the prophetic. So wisdom is the understanding of the promises in the written word of God. Revelation is the rhema word of God that comes to your spirit, man. Okay, the heart, another manifestation of grace is the fruit of the Spirit. It's the motives of Christ. The motives of Christ. Nothing more important than to have the motives of Christ, meaning the glory of God. I do it all for your Father, for you. The motives of Christ are the number one thing God's working on. Is I have a hidden life in God. So that's why all in the Sermon on the Mount, when God is talking about the constitution of the kingdom, he says, man, it's super important to have humility, it's super important to have meekness, and it's super important to be humble. So when you fast, do it in secret. When you pray, do it in secret. When you worship, make sure that your worship is done a lot in secret. You know, give in secret, pray in secret, fast in secret. You know, do a lot of stuff in secret. Why? Because it pulls the weeds of self-glory out of your heart. So motives of Christ, his glory, basically. His glory, which is worship. We're called for worship. We're called for his glory. What else? The fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, the affection, the kindness, the gentleness. The fruit of the Spirit, it says, God sheds his love abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Okay, Romans 5:5. Write that down. It's a supernatural pouring out of the influence of heaven. That's the grace of God. Now, so the grace of God hits our head, it hits our heart, and I'm going to just say it hits our hand, which is really our lifestyle. That's our lifestyle. Okay? The grace of God hits our minds. We get the mind of Christ, revelatory influence from the outside in. We get the motives, the heart, the love, the affection, supernatural, and we get the power to live the lifestyle of the kingdom. So that's what we're going to call the grace of God, the grace within. That's when it says, out of your innermost being will come rivers of living water. That's in John 8, I think. Out of your innermost being will come rivers of living water. So that's the kingdom within, or the grace within. See, the kingdom within. Christ dwells in your heart by faith. The kingdom within. The starting point for bringing the grace of God into the earth is through the interior life. So your Holy Spirit, your spirit, touches the Holy Spirit, and they commingle, and you appropriate the grace of God. Now, give you an example. The way you tap this grace now is by faith. The same way in the natural that you get from one place to another is by faith. The grace, it would be represented in your truck. Okay, that's graceness, truckness. Truckness is graceness, transportationness, truck engines, truck transmission, truckness. Truckness. We all love truckness. Now, the truck isn't going to drive itself, right? The truck is there. It's just sitting there with all this grace. How do you tap truckness? Faithness. You faith. Faith is a verb. You don't say, I just think intellectually that truck could get me from one place to another. I just believe the truck exists, and I believe it could get me there. That's not biblical faith. That's called intellectual assent. Biblical faith is when you get your rear end into the truck. Okay, that's faith. It's going to hold you up. It's not going to roll away. Secondly, you turn the key. That's faith, right? Faith is then boom, boom, boom. Faith is you put it in gear. Faith is you tap the gas. Faith is you touch the brake. Faith is you put on the blinker. Faith is you get from one place to the next. You faithed your way all the way here. Exactly. Faith is the other driver and going to kill you. And I go home on 287 every night. I mean, come on, man. I'm faithing. It's craziness. So you see what I'm saying now? It's the same with the spirit realm. In the fifth dimension, you go into that realm by faith, and you pull that power, that energy, that fire, that life into your spirit by faith. You faith, and it's faith is a verb. You're either faithing or you're not faithing. There's no in between. You're either driving the truck or you're not driving the truck. If you're not driving the truck, you're not faithing. You're either faithing or not faithing. There's no in-between. Religion creates an in-between world and calls it faith. It's called intellectual assent. So faith is spelled risk. The only way you're faithing is if you're in risk. If you're tapping into the other realm. If you can pull this off, you're in religion. Because the kingdom of God and the grace of God is a supernatural power from the other realm. It's not something you do in your own strength. You're pulling something, a life from another realm into your realm. So the Christian life is a supernatural life. If you've reduced it to doctrines, believing doctrines and quoting verses and having meetings, you are not operating in the biblical Christianity described here. You've got a Christian religion, you don't have the kingdom. Now that's the problem, is the church is in the Christian religion, not the kingdom, for the most part. We've lost the message of the kingdom. Now it's going to take a band of brothers that call each other out of a spirit of religion and into the kingdom. So we live supernatural. So I'm going to give you one example of how I tap this. I prayed Ephesians 1:17 for years, every day. May the spirit of wisdom and revelation hit me. And as I began to pray, the scriptures started becoming illuminated to me. I knew things by reading the word that I never would have figured out. They came by revelation. The Holy Spirit illuminated the word of God. It became very exciting to read. Okay, I'm going to give another even more dramatic. I was born to a very dysfunctional and damaging family. Very, very abusive father. And German, not hugging, no affirmation. To this day, it's been slim to none. And so the idea of hugging was very awkward for me. Affectionate language, I didn't have any point of reference to it. I was a very shut down and broken person, and to some degree walled up and detached and self-protecting. And I went through, I was always an extrovert. I was always, liked people, but I never had what I would call the affection of Jesus, because I never got it. So I go to seminary, I do really well, I go to, get my bachelor's degree, graduate with honors, real performance, real driven, German driven, get to seminary, 3 years, driven. I get out, I go into the ministry, and I'm building this youth ministry, and it's growing like crazy. I'm very successful on the outside, but I'm so driven. An old associate pastor in the church comes to me one night, invites us over for dinner and says, "Tim, I need to let you know something. Because I think you need to go and visit this guy." He slid a name and a phone number across the table. And it was the name of a shrink. And I go, "What are you talking about?" He goes, "I've never met anybody more gifted, more capable, more this, more that, more driven." He goes, "The energy by which you are so driven in," he goes, "the performance, the drivenness in your life," he says, "it scares me." He goes, "there's something off. There's something off." And I told him how awesome I was a couple more times. And he goes, "Oh, okay, I know. It's not what I'm talking about." He goes, "There's something in you that's not right." And he goes, "You need to go talk to this shrink." And the next thing I just start weeping. Now, I'm probably 27 years old. I'm an associate pastor in this big church. And so I did, and I spent the first 10 sessions telling the shrink at $100 an hour how awesome I was and how much I didn't need to be there. Finally, he called me out. I mean, he saw it immediately. He called me out, and he got me to rehearse the issues in my dad and my relationship and all that. And the next thing you know, I'm on the floor sobbing my eyes out, weeping, gagging. I'm in fetal position, and I'm just losing it. And it's dawning on me how jacked up I am. That I need healing. So what I did was, when I recognized that I had big time daddy wounds, I looked through all of the apostolic prayers on the subject of love and affection. And out of desperation, not out of just like fixing somebody else, out of my own orphanness, out of my own vacuums, out of my own dysfunction, I found all the love passages, because I actually didn't believe in the love of God. I knew it. I gave many messages on it. I knew it here. I didn't have it here. I never experientially touched affection in my life. I didn't even know what it was like. And so I went and read Ephesians 3. I read Philippians 1. I started reading these apostolic prayers for love, for a revelation of love, for an experience of love. And I would just like, I'd get on my face before the Lord, go, God, I'm like, I'm coming to you. I don't even know what this is I'm even praying for, but I need it really bad in my life. I'm shut down. It's showing in my marriage. And just the Lord began to open up my heart. He began to let a fountain of affection hit my spirit. And I began weeping before him. I could feel that affection flowing. And that's when I started thinking about, this feels like this warm, oozy, jelly-like. That's when I started getting the language, plus working with inner city kids and poor kids. I couldn't explain it except for crazy language. And I began to feel that inner shower bubble up of affection. And my heart was softening and opening and getting healed. And I just kept praying it. And it became addictive for me. And then the Lord goes, I want you to be an agent of my affection. And he began speaking to me about having a daddy's heart and loving every person I ever met and hugging them and really, and I hated to be hugged. I lost control. I hated to be hugged. Like my grandpa would literally go like this. Like, just, you go up to hug him and he's like, and that's, my dad would kind of like this and I would kind of like this, and it was just like, it was a generational curse. I was just like, oh. And he goes, I want you to release my affection through hugging. And then he started gushing me with affection to the point where I was losing control. And I would have to like lose control. And just, he said, I want you to go and hug everybody. I want you to kiss these guys by the Spirit. And I was like, this is going to be so friggin' crazy. Because I had a big vision of being, you know, a man's man. You know, I played college football. I love to fight. I love to beat people up. I love to do everything. I love to do everything, you know, badass guys do. And he goes, I want you to start hugging people and being gentle and being safe. And I'm like, I am not going to be coming off like a gay guy. I'm not. Now, I had nothing, you know, I had no prejudice against gay people. I just said, I'm not going to be a soft, effeminate person. He goes, you are going to manifest the greatest expressions of manhood ever. You're going to release affection. The affection anointing is going to come off of you. And then he made a promise. You will operate under my affection. And I was like, that is the exact opposite of what I grew up with. So I am like literally a miracle, because that flows through me. It's residential inside my spirit. Literally, I don't meet one person that I don't have a feelings of affection for. Now I have to throttle it back a little bit, because nobody wants to be, met like with a Great Dane, you know, like level of energy, having their face licked, and you know, you got to kind of, you know, tone it down and go in increments. So, but it's coming. It's coming. Mark my word, it's coming. So you get my point? That was a work of God in my spirit, man. So I accessed that grace by faith. All right, now, so there's all these promises here, here, and here. Now, let me go to the kingdom between us. That means you monitor the hearts of other people. That means you pray for oneness. That was Christ's biggest prayer, make them one. So you pray for a breakthrough of oneness at a heart level. That is a miracle. When people will soften their heart, and connect their heart to yours. And so that you can release the shimmering, plasmic, jelly-like affection of Jesus to them and them to you. That connection of hearts is a miracle. Do you understand? That's a miracle. Oneness is going to be the greatest sign and wonder that Laramie will ever see. When we move in the Word of God, the Spirit of God, and the family of God, when we move in those three things, that will literally take over Laramie. So the kingdom between, you do everything you can to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. And finally, the kingdom around us. Thy kingdom come on earth. Thy kingdom come in my business, just like we did with Aaron. My kingdom come in my family and my neighborhood. So there's grace for here, there's grace for here, there's grace for here. Now, a faith really is, which grace am I going to tap? Why wouldn't you set faith goals? A faith goal, okay, let's just look at it real quick. I know the time is getting right. A faith goal is a specific, I'm on page two, a specific measurable, observable result that activates and actualizes as a result of accessing God's grace. Okay, that was too complicated. Let me just read it one more time. A faith goal is a specific and measurable, observable result that materializes, that actualizes as a result of accessing God's grace. That's what a faith goal is. It's not work. It's not work. It's a discipline of accessing grace. A faith strategy is the specific step that you're going to take to access that grace. Because it always involves a step. Sometimes Jesus would say, you want to be healed? Okay. He would spit in the mud and wipe their eyes and say, now you go wash it off. He would make them get engaged in their healing. They had to step into something. They had to do something. Not that they work for it, they faith for it. Big difference. You didn't push your truck here. That would be working for it. You faithed your way here, appropriating truck power. Now, establishing a faith goal. Based on what you hear from the Holy Spirit, you establish priorities in these jurisdictions of grace, within, around, and between and around. And you set up faith goals that you could write them down. Like my faith goal would have been, I need to have a wide open heart that conducts and pumps the affection of the Father out of my heart. It's downloaded into me. He shed his love abroad in my heart. It comes from heaven through my spirit and then out. I need a pump. I need to start at God, open up the pump and begin to release divine flow of love in my heart. That was my faith goal. So I said, my faith goal is I am going to walk the planet manifesting the love of Jesus to everybody I meet. So what was the faith step? Begin to pray apostolic prayers, asking God to unleash that supernatural grace in my life. I knew I didn't have it. I'm super jacked up. There's no way I'm going to pull that off. I'm a mess. I can't even function well with a shrink. I can't even get well with a shrink's help. It took a supernatural breakthrough in God to get me there. So faith goal is basically, it sounds like a business deal, but it isn't. It's simply you exercise faith to get to grace. So on this little sheet, you know, right here, are areas of grace. It's in your notebook under the faith goals. And you ask, Holy Spirit, what are you emphasizing? What is the Holy Spirit's current emphasis in my life? And here are these jurisdictions of influence. And you go through and you say, Holy Spirit, what are you talking to me about right now? Are you talking about me personally? Are you talking about my natural family? How about my church family? How about my relationship to myself? How about my relationship with my neighbors and coworkers? What are you talking to me about, Holy Spirit? And I think it'd be a fun exercise for you to number the level of influence, the level of emphasis. If the emphasis is getting a number 10, and a lot of times you'll know by where you're hurting. Where you're hurting or where you're agitated is probably what the Holy Spirit's dealing with. Not to beat you up, but to grace you. To displace that hurt with his grace. So I just put categories in this because it's a tickler. It's a stimulator of a conversation that you need to have with the Holy Spirit. God, I want to be like Christ in my head, my heart, and my lifestyle. God, I want to have Christ-centered relationships. Christ, I want to see your kingdom come wherever I go. So what are you talking to me about right now? And then you set a faith goal. Now, why do we need each other? Because we need battle buddies. Faith is a fight. It's called the fight of faith for a reason. It says your work is to believe. How crazy is that? Look at that. Your work is to believe, John 6:29. Faith is a fight. John 6:29. It's in your notes. And also it says Faith involves a fight, 1 Timothy 6:12. It's called the fight of faith. All right, so this little handout goes in your faith goals section. So we need buddies. I would call them battle buddies or DNA groups where you have expressed to them and to God your faith goals. And those faith goals, then, they come into unity with you. They pray with you. They hold you accountable. They come into agreement with you. And they're shared, they're prayed over, and then they partner with you to access the grace of God. We help each other access the grace of God and reach others for Christ. And we do that in our MKFs. That's an acronym for Missional Kingdom Families. They're little house churches, micro churches. And in these little twos and threes called DNA groups. Discipleship, Nurture, Apostolic Mission. So you see those numbers in Scripture. Twos and threes, wherever two or three are gathered. You see that number. You see the number that two and three is a big number in Scripture. And the military's glomped onto that. They got battle buddies, right? Called a fire team. Or a platoon is 10, right? So the military has literally understood the sociological dynamics of numbers. So is business. The only people that didn't get this is the church. Because it wants to get people in herds and control their behavior. But a real kingdom family wants to deputize and invalidate every person and say, look, you're a legit son of God. Get with another man. Get in front of the Word of God. Set up some faith goals and grow in Jesus together for God's sake. And then get into a house church and let's start kingdomizing the planet. It's a little family platoon. So those two settings are really important. Really important. Twos and threes. Tens or 15s, whatever the number, 5 to 15. All right, tonight, what time are we at?
8:25.
What? 8:25. Okay, 8:25. I'd like you to partner up with two people, three people, and I'd like you to kind of scan that, those two sheets I gave you, and I'd like you to even just experiment with one faith goal in either the area of the kingdom within or the kingdom between. Let's say your relationships stink. So he's like, I need to set a faith goal to appropriate unity. And so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to learn how to have a better marriage. And I'm going to read this book. So my faith goal is I'm going to learn about the principles of a kingdom marriage. And I'm going to ask Tim Johns what book he recommends or what training he recommends about marriage. Okay, that would be a faith goal. It's a measurable result. And then you're going to go through that body material and you're going to come up with the five top principles of how to have a successful marriage. That would be a faith goal. I'm going to appropriate the grace of God. I'm going to get the wisdom of God. I'm going to be a better husband. So I'd love for you to practice. Now, don't get all freaked out, okay? Just know that there's a lot of grace here. And just a little faith, a mustard seed faith, will appropriate more grace. So get into groups of two and three. And what I want you to do is I want you to declare one faith goal in one category that's something that God's put on your heart for you to work on. Okay? That you're going to need supernatural help in. In other words, it's not something you can do. You need the supernatural help of God. Okay? One faith goal. That's it. And then we're done. We're out of here. So I'm not there. You can turn off the camera there. Okay? One faith goal. And then if you really want to be awesome, write it down.